Michele Rigby Assad is a former undercover officer in the CIA's Directorate of Operations, and she joins me now. So, Michele, I know there's a lot you can't talk about, but what can you tell us about the kind of work you were engaged in at the agency to prevent attempted terror attacks like the one we saw in New York Monday morning?
So I worked for 10 years in the clandestine service. So that entailed working overseas undercover, primarily in the Middle East region, as a counterterrorism officer. So as part of that job, you have to meet with sources and collect intelligence you need to stop terrorist attacks from occurring. So the plans and intentions of terrorist groups and what they intended to do. And so our job is to try to figure that out and then stop these things before they carry them out.
New York Mayor Bill de Blasio said the city would be stepping up security in response to the bombing, yet the NYPD is already one of the largest police forces in the world. Can we realistically prevent this sort of violence?
Well, as we used to say at the CIA, the terrorists only have to get it right once. We have to get it right every single time. So it's a really tall order, and I know law enforcement agencies, CIA and DOD, are working really hard to try to get the intelligence we need about what they're planning. But it's nearly impossible to stop every attack from occurring. And so I like to encourage listeners that one of the best tools that we have in our counterterrorism toolbox are our listeners, are our community members.
And so just to follow up on that, we are all familiar with that phrase, see something, say something, but what exactly is it that we should be looking for? What kind of behavior raises a red flag?
So, in fact, there are always red flags. There are always things that people could have seen ahead of time. And so, if you have a friend or a family member that you think is potentially being radicalized, it's being able to recognize that there's an increased level of hatred, increased talk against the community or the United States, and having the courage to speak up and say something to authorities.
And the suspect in Monday's attack is from Bangladesh and entered the U.S. on an immigrant visa in 2011. He obtained a green card and became a permanent resident. You recently wrote about the migrant crisis in Europe. Do you see any kind of connection to that as it with respect to what we are seeing here in the United States?
Yes. Unfortunately, it is very difficult to start a new life in a new country, no matter how prepared you think you are. But so many of the migrants that I have spoken with, I was really amazed by how many of them were military-aged males that were without their families. And so when they're not a part of that very strong community system, and also so many of them lack the skill set to compete in the local economy for jobs, it is very difficult to integrate into their new lives. And so what you have are a lot of individuals that lack a sense of purpose and are unsure what to do with themselves, and they're very ripe to be radicalized and manipulated by propagandists and ideologues with al-Qaeda and ISIS.
So do you think that part of a safety solution has to look at immigration?
Absolutely. I think that it's a very important conversation we should be having about how we can help migrants integrate. It is incredibly difficult to do so, but what I found out in conversations with the young men we were speaking with is that they felt like a sense of, they were kind of angry about their situations. They were promised by a lot of them by people smugglers certain things on the other end of the equation, so they landed in places like Europe and the United States. States completely unprepared for what they were going to deal with. And job creation, job skills development, that's a key part of this conversation that we're really not talking so much about these days.
Yeah, there's certainly a debate about whether or not the immigration system needs to be changed, and in fact, legal immigration limited into the United States. But that's perhaps a more extended conversation for another time. Let me ask you about your intelligence background. Beyond beefing up physical defenses, are there other ways in which we can improve security?
Sure. So the most important thing to tell viewers this evening is that there's so much that we can do just by being aware. So it's understanding where you are most vulnerable, where and when you're vulnerable. So this holiday season, with ISIS issuing a communique last week specifying that attacks would be carried out in New York, Paris, London, Vatican City, and San Diego, is understanding that we need to be very aware of our surroundings when we're in a target-rich environment. So wherever we go, that shopping malls, Christmas, church, synagogue events, we need to be cognizant that we are at a heightened risk of attack in those specific areas. So when you go out, I'm not telling people to change what they normally do, but to say, okay, now is the time that I need to turn it on. I need to be aware of my surroundings, and I need to be ready to react if, God forbid, something does happen. So instead of freezing, being able to respond by getting out of the zone where the attack is being carried out. So my message is one of not fear, but empowerment, and encouraging people to really pay attention when they are the most vulnerable.
All right. Michele Rigby Assad, thanks so much, Michele, for your time.
Thank you, Elaine.